position players are having.
Yeah, I agree. I think one thing that they can really do to adjust themselves is at least just not go so greedy. I feel like whenever, like in a couple of the games where they lose, it's just like they have these like 3-4 heroes that take so much time to get online that they lose the laning phase way too hard. They have such a struggle to get back in the mid game. I think the best thing they can do is really just draft these early game, early team fighters, early lane dominators in kind of a fashion. Avoid the Slark, avoid the Tinker unless they have a very hard, like a very safe carry in the laning phase.
Yeah, they are famous for running Rubick. We saw Rubick ban out against them all three games, and it seems like Digital Chaos is going to leave it in the pool this time. They ban out the Pudge, which, you know, we mentioned it, understandable. They ban out Isotize Nyx Assassin, which we have seen being very dominant as well, or at least space creating, active across the map. And for Faceless, who will have second pick this game, they ban out the Shadow Demon. Surprises so far?
I think that's Faceless' two best heroes. Even like, I mean, Pudge is the newcomer kind of thing, even though Black's been playing it for so long. The Nyx was Isis's most dominant hero, even before Boston.
Also, good ban if they want to go into like an early Ember Spirit pick, but yes, not going to be their first pick anyways. First pick, Venge.
Venge?
Wow.
I mean, they showed this in game three where they were just like, pick Venge Legion first too. I don't know about this support Venge as like an opening pick.
Not convinced. I mean, he couldn't really protect Resolution's Naga Siren in the previous game they had, where Naga didn't come online early enough, but perhaps they have a better chance against Faceless, who, as we mentioned, doesn't have as crisp of a laning stage as Team Secret had that specific game. Rubick picked up. Now, this Rubick, we have no clue where this Rubick is going to go, because they play it in multiple positions. Same can be said for the Vengeful Spirit, in a way.
Yeah.
So keeping it open, let's see what they pick up next. I mean, is there any heroes that you would like to see come out from Faces for this one? A core specifically?
The Ember.
The Ember, yeah.
Yeah. Ember is probably the biggest one that stands out for me. They really like showing their two supports right off the bat, just putting it out there. This is the second or third time in this tournament that already they first two picks, they show their hand.
Yeah, they did the Witch Doctor the Pudge.
Okay. Well, they're just putting it out there. Like it's aggressive. That's a good thing. Like the Earth Spirit, I like that they do it because it's just aggressive early game as well. But okay,
it's very different to what like we saw Secret do, where they first two pick Luna Ember. You know, it's like, oh, yeah, Here's what we're doing. Can you beat it? And I guess Faceless just don't. Like, I guess the kind of cores they like aren't like the top tier one pick cores, so they don't really care if they don't get it in the first two because they can be kind of more flexible. Drow Strats.
With Avenge too, so they've got the double aura, Mace Armor.
Against an Earth Spirit, it's kind of risky. That's what we saw Jerax completely dismantle VP with.
Oh, yeah.
But
Jerax and XY are spreads though, right? That's a little bit of a difference, yeah. I would say.
Still, it is always risky to show your hand at the start of the game. A Drow Ranger strat, everybody knows what you're going to do. You're going to push hard early on. The mid game is where you come to shine. Faceless has all the time in the world to prepare for that.
Yeah. Darkseer banned out from DC. Pairs super well with their spirit. Faceless also liked a decent amount when Isis doesn't have his space creators. The Invoker ban, yeah. Weeha Invoker,
yeah.
With the Drow Ranger, just they probably want to just be focusing their bans on these, you know, ranged like, kind of semi carries in the mid lane.
Yeah, we saw Jabs have sometimes a little bit of issues in the mid lane as well. He needs a lot of help from the previous games that we saw from them. Spirit is a great one for helping.
Yeah, he got solo killed by Sumail, I think, in two of the three games, yeah. I want to say.
I mean, Sumail is not an easy mid to go up against.
Yeah, no, absolutely.
So, you
not
know,
fair.
Of all the mids, but then, you know, you're going up against Weeha as well, which is also not an easy task.
I think that's why it's important for them to avoid something like Slark for Black so that they can help them in. Like,
yes.
Slark is a hero, you have to help him the whole entire laning phase. So I think they should go for something like their Juggernaut. They seemed like very comfortable with it. Black seemed to have just a little bit of struggle on it in that third game, but overall in his early and mid game, he had very good decision making, and they were very close to winning that game.
That's where a lot of teams are playing Jug and the other one, the Life Sealage, because you can leave these heroes in like a 1v1 against an offlaner, and the supports can roam around, and you're not worried about that hero not getting farming experience. Yeah, you're giving the other offlaner a bit more out of the lane, but you're getting something elsewhere on the map.
Well, it is over to Faceless to decide what they are going to go for next, so they're going to have to reveal possibly a core. Again, we don't know what that Rubick is going to be doing. Time to reveal one more card.
They should probably go for Isis' hero. I think saving Black's hero is decent, because they have multiple options. They have the Lifestealer and the Jug. I think those are the two best, just to get in Drow Ranger's face. You have, you have a kind of a vehicle with the Earth Spirit in that manner to get on top of the Drow Ranger.
Now, normally when you go up against a Drow Ranger, you go for the aggressive Trilon, or at least you try to have at least an offlane that can pressure her, or at least contest her in last hits. Do you feel like they're going to go for an aggressive duo slash Trilon, anything that would fit Ice's hero? Is Magnus the right hero to do that with?
I think it's more going to be like a Magnus Jug type strat again, similar to what they did game 3. This is not a hero that you normally do like kind of dual lanes in the offlane so much. Maybe Earth Spirit comes up if the supports get too aggressive, but Magnus just wants to like Iron Talon jungle a bit, get his XP, get his farm. It's a very passive offlaner who's not looking to contest the lane.
Does get in the face of Drow later too. It's a heavy team fight already coming out from Faceless versus the, you know, the Drow strat that we already talked about from DC.
DC just gonna steal that jug, run a mid, take it away.
They could. They definitely could have all the chance to if they want to deny that. Or they could pick something up that they know is gonna be good against it. Which heroes would be able to deal with a Juggernaut? A Weaver?
Support Weaver?
Could definitely be could definitely be the support Weaver. Since versus Rubick, Earth Spirit, they have a lot of, they have a decent amount of disable form already. Rubick now has a very good spell to steal with that. But yeah, focusing more on like the minus armor, it's like heavy physical damage oriented lineup coming up from DC versus Faceless. 5 seconds
remaining. Yeah, curious to see what they look to build around the Magnus. Mention the Jug, but there are other kind of melee carries you can pair for the Empower. Mm-hmm.
PA comes to mind.
Ooh.
A great gap closer to the Drow Ranger.
That was the big thing that we saw at Boston. Every time somebody picked Drow Ranger, it was like instantly PA, bam, right in your face. So, definitely a possibility. You did say it, Ryan, in the mid lane. Very good call.
Nice. The synergy with the Magnus is there. And they got the Silence already from the Earth Spirit as well, so they have, I feel like they have got quite enough tools to deal with the Weaver, even if it is a core. If it turns out to be one.
There's also flexibility with the PA for the lanes. Like, they can wait to see what DC pick up with both their 4th and 5th pick before they decide, okay, do we want the PA mid or in the safe lane?
Yep. Absolutely.
So they don't have to worry about the PA, like, losing in the laning stage.
Is it exclusive that Ice only plays the mag? I think I saw Jabs play the mag at Boston. It's been a while, but I think recently it's more so just been Ice.
There are flexibility options for both teams, but more so for Faces. I mean, you mentioned that maybe they're going to try to go for a little bit of a cheese strat. Maybe, you know, it doesn't really look like any kind of a cheese type of draft right now, but they can definitely throw a curveball.
They're kind of showing they just saw what Secret did with the PA, and they're like, oh yeah, let's try some of that.
That looked decent.
That looked pretty good.
Right, so Digital Chaos, they kind of know what to deal with. They have got maybe a little bit lack of lockdown right now.
I think they want like a magic damage type hero in the mid lane. They don't want more right click. They're going to be too all in at that point. PA has the evasion. Getting some kind of like Queen of Pain type hero for mid could be an option.
I would like, we haven't seen Queen of Pain either. I really would like it. It's a hero that's very strong this patch. And seems to be getting ignored a lot in this tournament, except for on the last ban. I think we've seen it like 2 or 3 times being banned out with.
I thought Queen of Pain. I don't know. I mean, if they want to go all into the push, it's the obvious like Dragon Knight type
Dragon
hero,
Knight,
but can control the PA a bit, but doesn't. So, there we go.
I don't need to do anything. Thank you, guys. Thank you, Shin.
I mean, if we can read the draft as we just did, then surely the players will know what's coming as well.
No, Shiva, we know more than that. Don't say that.
Okay. They know nothing.
I really liked, as soon as you mentioned the Quap, I was like, PA is a hero that takes time. He's squishy throughout all stages. Yeah. Queen of Pain has the massive burst potential, wins the lane as well with the Drow Aura. Fits exactly what they need to have that mixed damage potential on their lineup.
Just need that offlane initiator for DC, most likely.
And if you are going to run a Queen of Pain mid, you do not want to play Phantom Assassin against that. So
no,
what
not.
Mid hero for Jabs comes to mind against Queen of Pain?
Could
Queen of Pain
Rubick
is a very strong
mid?
Laner.
Do you switch Rubick the Rubick still, to a mid?
Yeah,
against
Jabs
or...
plays Rubick mid as well. They ban out the Puck?
I guess
banning out the off there.
Thinking offlane Puck, but with the Drow, that's something OG used to a bit, and some teams like to pair with Drow.
Massive amount of burst damage potential with that Puck as well, so I think that's a good ban. Just disrupts the whole entire team fight that they have. I think it's a little greedy right now coming up with Faceless, so they need something that can tie in and fight very early, because like all these heroes kind of require their levels, PA requires farm, Mag wants a 6, Mag wants Blink Dagger, ideally.
Yep. That's why I feel like a Rubick mid is a bit less greedy. That's why you send him there, he doesn't have to dominate on farm, he's more of the tempo-controlling type hero.
Well, let's see what Digital Chaos thinks that Rubick is going to do, because they ban out Slark, so they ban out a core.
And they go for the bat, so the moon bat.
Yeah, and Slark would have been a hero that isn't too afraid of versing a bat in lane, although I'm not sure it would have been the best to fit in Faceless's draft. Right, Falk, me and Cheever have done one. Last pick's yours.
Oh god.
No pressure.
Too open-ended. You don't want PA mid, so Jab's mid hero.
Yeah, you don't even know what role it is.
It's either Rubick or
could be
support.
Carry, oh, could god. Be mid, could be support, yeah. Could be three different roles. Could be an offlane if they want to do mag mid, you know?
Yeah, they could still leave it very open.
They could pick anything except a full position.
I hope it's not Tinker.
Okay, to be fair, we have only seen Nuts play the Witch Doctor and the Winter Wyvern so far.
Yes.
So if they do run Jabs and the Rubick, then one of those heroes, would those fit?
Wyvern's decent versus Drow Ranger strats. Decent.
Decent.
Not great against... Weaver can be really annoying to us.
Oh, hello. And a little bit of
okay, I don't think any of us were going to call that.
I would not ever say that hero, because I still don't think that hero is actually very good. I think he just takes too long to come online, and they already have a lot of ways to clear the illusions, as well as... I guess you can kind of get in Drow Ranger's face, kind of, in a way, but...
Phantom Rush in, you got Manta to get out of the silence, but that's a really odd last pick.
Yeah, we mentioned that Faces was not the strongest in the laning stage, and it looks like they might struggle on this one as well.
I think their lineup is way too greedy to deal with DC. I did say Faces before the draft, but afterwards, I'm all for DC.
Jumps, Jim? How about you guys?
I want to see how the PL works. I'm like, kind of reserving judgment, because I want to believe they're onto something with this last pick PL, but I mean, I think DC being slightly favored.
DC slightly favored. Any timings that we gotta look out for in this game? Like, the laning stage is everything in this game, or not?
I just think it's gonna be too hard for them to... They're gonna come out at such a deficit of the laning stage.
So what needs to happen for them to win this?
Earth Spirit needs to do...
No pressure.
I think he's the big player that needs to come up. And then on the DC side, it's what Misery can do on the support Weaver as far as his impact on the game.
Okay, well, we are going to find out if that Earth Spirit can have as much impact as he needs to have. It is over to our commentators for the only game. It's the best of one for the elimination game.
Word. We're going to start with the word odd, Malini.
PL's good, dude.
PL is... I'm not going to go against that, even with the illusion change-up. It seems odd anyway, but it's Faceless. It's meant to be odd. It's their thing.
I think you're just trying to take away from the fact that you thought it was going to be a mid-Rubick the whole time.
That is potentially possibly right. I was sitting there, but they were also tossing it up as well, if it was going to be that mid-Rubick. But it's not. It's going to be PL into that mid lane. Going for them, but DC's draft looks very, very stable across the board too.
I like PL mid versus the Queen of Pain. You can doppelganger off the Shadow Strike. He also has a lot of agility, so he gets extra benefit from the Empower. Also, Digital Chaos have pretty terrible AoE. You're mostly just the Queen of Pain, unless you want to go for the Ags, Maelstrom, Drow in the late game. But
that's still going to take a decent amount of time, and by that point, you're probably expecting everyone to be in power buff up and have a lot of initiation from Faceless.
Yeah, you have to deal with RP. That's the one big problem I see going late game into the Drow lineup.
Yeah. It's also one of those fun little things too when they run their Rubick. Obviously they bypass going for the damage and go for the gold per minute, and Nuts will walk around with Aghanim, Scepter's, Blink Dagger's, 4 starves. He's giving a real big control run. That's kind of what I like about both of the supports coming out from Faceless. Combining the Earth Spirit, who's already been like the king of control throughout this tournament, and then add the Rubick on top of it. It's just a lot to work together. But I'm with the panel as well. Like, it's gonna be a rough laning phase for Faceless.
Is it? I don't think so. I don't think it's that bad. Queen dominates most matchups, but Phantom Lancer, I think, is one of the few melee heroes that actually does pretty decently because of the doppelganger. And of course, you do have the Earth Spirit threat on their side. Bottom lane, Batrider versus PA. It's going to be a wash, I would say. Probably slightly Batrider favored in that. I don't really think they can kill the Batrider at all in that matchup. Magnus versus this tri-lane. Yeah, Mag. Probably just needs to skewer away, play pretty safely. I definitely think DC has the edge, but I don't necessarily think it's that one-sided.
I want to see Ice's positioning. Like, this Observer Ward that he managed to get down is, in fact, really, really useful, because it's going to make it so at least his lane should be pushing out all the time towards him. So he won't get in that position where potentially Sun gusted and then just killed off by the cold arrows and damage that the draw ranger provides.
I wonder if you can actually do some creep pulling shenanigans with the Magnus. Like if there's a ranged creep in the large camp, if you can like skewer yourself away. Kind of like
the you do like with the Io?
Yeah. It's possible.
That timing's gonna be a lot more difficult. Like Io seems a lot more fluid. Like when you do the skewer, you got that little wind up beforehand, you gotta wait for him to attack.
It's possible.
Or you just take the creep with you.
You can't skewer creeps.
That's a shame. Nerf, please. Pudge is already too imbalanced. Like,
what, you want to make it so he can't hook creeps?
Yeah, it's the indirect nerf, so Magnus can actually skewer creeps now. That would be a dream. That would be a nightmare in team fights. All right, ice. Oh, skewer. He's going to drag in Misery underneath the tower. There's no Shikuchi on Misery. It'll take a lot of damage. Underneath the observe ward, he knew he was going to be okay, but one more hit would have done it. He doesn't have skewer for a while. Misery, quick Shikuchi, and then just runs away. Does the damage. And that's going to be all, but...
What if they had a Sentry Ward there? This really would have been so sad. They would.
No, it was close. It was just a little bit further to the north.
We just Shadow Strike, Jeb just Doppelganger. I wonder if he's actually going to max the Shadow Strike. I don't really think it's a great idea versus the PL, but it is very good versus most of their other heroes. Generally, one level is enough if you want to like stop a Magnus's Blink or damage a PA, however. Mm-hmm.
Looks like Moonori had to burn through a large amount of his consumables early on in the bot lane. Erspur is waiting for his initiation, just twitching with his stick on the bot lane. Black has the ability to jump in quickly too. And there's no Firefly until now. Like, Moon has hit his level 2, so if he needs to level it up, he can do so. But now, Rolling Boulder, short range, Nuts coming in close too. If he can just reach him in time, but with no boots, he won't get in range to get that quick little telekinesis grab and throw back. But they force the abilities out for Moon at least.
Black also doesn't have a stout shield. He was taking creeps quite a bit, but he has plenty of regen to deal with it. And they managed to deward that pretty cleverly placed observer ward, it seems. So looks like ISS will not be able to get that much out of the top lane, especially with that observer ward eyeing his possible Iron Talon / jungling movements.
Oh, that's a fun little rune to have. Can at least screw around with the camp if he wants to wait to the 3-minute mark. Misery's gonna say hi. A quick little haste room maneuver. Also want to keep my eyes on that Earth Spirit. He's a big rotating hero that's done so much this weekend already, and he's hovering around the mid. Weeha's already back pretty defensively on his tower.
And Wee's like at full HP. I don't think there's any way they kill the Phantom or kill the Queen of Pain in this situation, especially with the bottle coming out right now. Maybe if he aggressively blinks, but that's also pretty unlikely given the matchup.
This observer was done so much for DC. Now seeing XY rotate to the top lane, so they understand that the Earth Spirit is up here. Potentially that'll work with the Magnus. If they can get us on the skewer, they're probably assuming they can find that kill on the top lane. Many teams have tried to prey on Ice's over aggressiveness or slide positioning, which it looks like you can find a kill. But this trap's not going to work, so it's just straight back to farming for the Magnus, and then let the Earth Spirit soak up the experience in the lane.
But as mentioned, DC are crushing in the lanes. Queen of Pain, 16 CS2, the only 6 of the PL. Probably exacerbated by the fact that there is a Drow Ranger on the safe lane who has 22, pretty comparable in terms of the safe laners.
Shab's actually missed his Phantom Rush. He challenged up the hill, but I don't know if he just bossed the attack on Weeha. But his rush never connected with Wee. So that Observer Ward again sees the rotation. Knowing Earth Spirit's coming back down to the mid lane, Misery is also moved over as well. And this is giving a lot of space to Resolution. This is going to be a very quick level 6 because the supports aren't even having to stand on the lane.
It's giving a lot of space to everyone.
He's getting all of the experience.
Batrider is also just getting free levels on the bottom lane. I don't really think they can kill him just because they have to chase under Firefly as a melee hero. That's not really the ideal situation for killing a Batrider.
Ice just got scouted out, coming up a little bit too far with the Cold Arrow. Slow him up, but he gets the skewer quickly away.
There's a TP on the bottom lane. They're just making a move on Moon.
They can bring him down. Back. With the kick, Fairy Fire as well as one touch. That's a lot of life and still fighting inside the Firefly. A lot low life for XY. He's almost burning out. He needs one last little kick, but the arrow The Stifling Dagger out from Black. Revenge will be here from Misery. A quick TP in, so he'll get revenge in the form of both the supports to face us a safe lane.
Nice TP by Misery to really clean things up. Earthspear was caught in between a tree and a lane of fire. So, couldn't really move unless he wanted to die. A lot of napalm sacks. Moon created a lot of space there. And we'll TP him in, fill up Wii's bottle. And back to bottom lane he goes.
And the He's doing really well. Oh, Weeha. That was no pickup. Oh, Jasmine have had a little bit longer to hit into him. They went for the Fade Bolt before the Telekinesis grab. So Weeha just blinks back up to the high ground in a way. Dire actually have, yeah, they have that one Observer Ward sitting on their side of the river. So it sees nuts, but it didn't see the Earth Spirit. Roll him in, pick him up, and this time around, they find the kill on Weeha.
They were just fluffing him up.
Fluffing him up. You make him sound like a pillow. You look tired. Have a nap while dead.
Poor Queen.
It was a hard life, especially when like, she was having such a good time in lane. Now it's 18-6 to the 22-11. The Draw Ranger is still shredding the CS wall.
They're getting a lot of farm on the jungle Magnus though. He has 2 points in power, which is really, really strong. The Iron Talon. So, yeah, Drow Ranger's getting farm, but keep in mind that I think Faceless's net worth is a little bit better spread out.
How's it looking overall? Okay, so it's only like 400, 300 in favor of DC. Very, very, very negligible for the early start. Nuts. Gonna say hello to Misery. Gets hit by the Beetle, and well, his creep's trying to help him out, but Nuts knows he needs to get a Telekinesis grab. He's gonna survive this. Can't see Misery. We'll see Moon, but Misery's already found that kill, and Moon's moving closer towards Black. Has to kite it around the tower. So won't find the kill on the PA, and Black very defensively TPing out. Potentially could have fought Moon there. No level 6 lasso up for the Batrider yet.
He does have a Helm of Dominator, grabbing that Mud Golem creep up nice and early.
Well, this is a nice little trap. The Observer Ward's gone from the Secret Shop area, so this will allow Faceless to move undercover. So, Nuts, they start with the first hit, the roll, that's very far off target from XY. And Zuxa maybe thinking he can have a crack, but no. Resolution has his level 6, but probably needs that extra point up in cold arrows before he's really going to have an opportunity to get that nice little kite damage kill.
Yeah, or his lance. He's very close to his lance. Jabs in the mid lane, taking a little bit of harass from Misery and Wii, but he has a lot of armor.
And Misery's taking a lot of damage too, so you go into that double gang and Misery wants to jump up. The lances fly. Sonic Wave from Weeha will miss. Rolling boulder forward as we have ourselves a quick pause. That sentry ward from Jabs, that's what allowed him to go for the initial lance, but Misery moved just far enough north to get out of range of it.
Let me say, mouse issues.
Yes. Having hang.
It wouldn't have killed him, regardless.
Yeah, he would have survived.
Yeah, 290 damage, I think he had like 410 at the time. Force him to be scared, pop his stick. Divert the support's attention.
You're fine with that if you're Jabs. You've still got your shrine to activate. If you want to move down to that, with the Earth Spirit also engaging, so Jabs can throw himself another lance out if they can keep vision of the Weaver. It's 2 or 3 seconds until that Shikuchi's going to come back off cooldown. So if Earth Spirit can get a combo.
He's really far away from Misery. I don't think you can get a lance on him. Maybe if they had a sentry ward in the area, but that is not the case.
Well, so he'll probably get to come back after the pause in a second and just watch Misery escape, potentially. Rune's getting up in Black's face still. But Black, I don't think he's going to be too sad about this now. Like, Black's still sitting at 3k net worth. Yeah, he's about 800, 900 behind that of the Drow, but he's also getting high enough levels that he'll feel confident enough to initiate onto the Batrider. And with so many one charges, plus having the Dominator up his sleeve, this is, in fact, kind of Black's bread and butter for a safe lane. He likes having these one-on-one matchups at this point, because he wants the solo kill.
Mm-hmm.
That's what he, and that's going to just propel him forward a long, long way.
I'm surprised he doesn't have a Blightstone. I think any of the orbs actually synergize very well on the on the PA. Orb of Venom if you're a support, and Blightstone if you're a core. He's already level 7, that crit just does tremendous amounts of damage. Although Batrider does already have his Trinkle Boots.
Yes, so he's got some decent armor, like sitting at 6, but as you said, like if he does have the Blightstone, he can still get through.
It just makes that like crit sting that much more, and you're in that HP threshold where you could just die.
It's actually gonna be an interesting thing going into the later game too. Like the range of Stifling Dagger, like I think got nerfed a couple of patches ago, but it's
only the lower levels.
Only the lower levels. So even when we go to later game, then if you have that vision over on Moon, you disable Blink Daggers at like the worst time. And as far as DC's initiation goes, Moon's kind of it. Like you got the swap, but if you do that, you sacrifice your Vengeful Spirit straight away.
Mm-hmm.
So how do you get the initiation and still hold the advantage? Because you're looking at a lot of potentially very squishy heroes who get caught out. Yeah, you've got Time Lapse to escape, you've got Gust and potentially Dragon Lance to push the Drow Ranger away. But I'm concerned if a fight goes wrong for DC, it can go horribly wrong for DC. And that's saying that up against a team who has a Magnus, which can make things go horribly wrong.
Later on, they have fail safes. They'll have the time lapse on the Weaver with Ags, especially because he's already on a killing spree, 3-0-0 on Misery, and then they also have the defensive swap onto the Ventral Spirit. So if they all in on a hero like the Drow Ranger or the Queen of Pain, it could easily be turned around with those defensive abilities. So RP is not the end-all be-all team fights.
That's a good point. You kind of forget about the Aghanims over on the Weaver.
Oh, I never forget. I harped that thing up. Dude, that thing is amazing.
You shut it down earlier on day one. You shut it down. Was that fog to shut it down?
No, I think they had something else, though, to deal with. They had like an SD or something else to kind of save a hero. But if you don't have any defensive saves, that thing is amazing. I mean, that thing is just amazing in general.
Mm-hmm.
Time lapse.
And then Rubik gets Aghanim Scepter and steals it.
That might be a while.
Definitely could be. Especially the ability to actually steal time-lapse, because Weaver's just pumping Shikuchi out all the time.
Dude, Rubik doesn't even have boots.
Life is hard for him.
60 GPM will solve all his problems.
It really does. It really does. Unless he wants to do it the old-fashioned way, with old-fashioned farming, and then he goes for the 50+ damage. Which is not really needed.
I don't really think you'd go for it in this lineup. I mean, you'll be hitting creeps now and then, but I think it's going to be pretty fast and furious.
Well, the goal per minute. Heavy farm. I'm trying to remember Jabs' build, actually, when he went for the mid. Because I got a funny feeling he went for that, like, Hand of Midas kind of style. And then went for the goal per minute as well. And he hit this huge item spike around the mid game. Had a hell of a lot of damage. But yeah, can't remember that one for now. Either way, looks like we're going to have Queen of Pain reconnect back into the game, which is an upside.
There were sighting of PC issues.
So we're going to give it a try. So we can come straight back into the game now, and we'll see if Misery can escape. The kick is well off target from XY, and Misery would just Shikuchi away to safety.
As you said, Toby.
Black Moon, you are really low. Mindbreak will give him some space, and it was the one charge that gave him a little bit more life. Black, he doesn't have Phantom Strike available, and won't run any further through that Firefly.
Bet he wishes he had a Blightstone.
He probably did.
Just seeing a little bit extra damage. I also don't know where this creep was. He did have a Mud Golem earlier, but I can't seem to see
it. I think it was running it through the Firefly.
Hmm.
And into the Dire Creep Wave. So, lost it that way. At least everything seems to be working, so try is succeeding. Resolution now has that Dragonlance, so welcome to the extra range over on the Drow Ranger. This is a horrible place, actually, for Nuts to be. Has to sit on top of the tower and use Fable to drag the wave down. And with three heroes ready to go, they have the sentry wards that can see Misery just shikuching his way in closer. They keep the Earth Spirit right behind. TPs are on their way. Misery, well, the kick does come in. It's over on the Vengeful Spirit. And as Phantom Assassin, Black comes up to the top lane, looking for the kill on the VS. It should be pretty much guaranteed, especially when Nuts has that Fade Bolt level 3 back off cooldown. So they stop the DC push into the tier 1 tower, but the tower's still down to 50%.
And look at Moon, already just mildly creep skipping. And this tower, I think, is going to die very, very shortly. Resolution's okay. Already used Precision Aura.
Oh, Lasso's coming in. Resolution's got Gust available. They're going to get the Silence onto the Magnus, trying to keep their distance away from the RP with the Flame Break. They know he was going to tick out. The Skewer's going to be off target, but now it's Moon being chased down. The perfect kick out from XY. Rolling Boulder forwards. The Moon will fall, but the Revenge is tit for tat right now on the bottom lane. Throwing the Lance after Resolution, slowing him down, but Nuts comes in, but in comes the reinforcements. Weeha will arrive. Sonic Wave is on cooldown. He still has that Scream available if he wants to kill Nuts off that way. With the Scream in the attack, he'll actually do so.
Too much damage on the Magnus there, he thought he could tank it all, but nice combination of the Gust into the Flame Break just made it impossible for Magnus to reach a Drow Ranger.
And this rotation works even better for DC. Yeah, you fail, you push up on the top lane, but you take the fight, and then you take the tier 1 tower on bottom lane. Successful rotation for Resolution, and TP's coming back off cooldown. He can go straight back up to the top lane and start all over again.
Moon's getting so much from this early game. Bat, one of the premier offlaners, I would say. Very difficult to zone out, and this game seems to be no different.
Mm-hmm.
There's a DD, but Misery will yoink it right under the watching eyes of Jabs.
Well, those watching eyes actually don't see that much. You look for the vision, you look for the wards out, and the only observer what is watching the rotation down to bottom lane through the rune, through the rune spot.
And he's going for Silver Edge on the Drought Ranger, it looks like, to deal with the Phantom Assassin. Very common pickup.
The Hunter's on. Digital Chaos. Top tower is still at 100%, so if DC want to try and defend this, they potentially can, but with a double damage rune on Misery, they may even just win as the trade-off pushing into the mid tower, because the Catapult Wave has already arrived.
Yep, Precision Aura proc again for Resolution, and it should be another T1 down. Black has pushed, bought the Blight Stone so he can push towers maybe a little bit slower than DC, but still respectable.
And they actually might even want to wait for the gank. They've got a small Dark Troll Summoner, that's what he's dominated up at the moment. Sitting on the other side of the hill. And our Resolution back behind the tower, VSTP's in, and it's taking them too long. Plus the Observer Ward they planted up near the Shrine scouted Moon's movement to the top lane. This might be an easier one if they can catch out Queen of Pain, but no vision on their side of the river.
She just struts through their jungle.
They're looking for the ward again. They're wondering if it's visible, which it is not. We turn it again into another push. Dominated creep on the bottom. We saw Ice do this earlier today. And power up his creep, push in with a set of blasts, and just attack into the tier 1 towers. Keep this battle as much of a split push as possible.
Just want to slow down a draw as much as you can.
Yep, Nuts potentially caught out. Misery's not really going to attack in. VS putting down a nice aggressive Observer Ward. Considering he was attacked by the tower, it kind of like leans towards knowing the fact that Ward got put down. Bottom lane, Magnus. Skewer is available. Weeha, I think he was looking to dodge it. The Skewer will actually drag Moon back because that brings the Firefly along with it. Back up to the top lane, a three-man Gust. Resolution, is there the stun? Yes, there is. Some dominated Centaur. So Resolution won't get out. Black with a double kill. Misery, a quick Shikuchi down through the river. Outed out by the Observer Ward. But there's still two heroes for the prize of one plus the tower in favor of DC.
Man, that Centaur Stomp. Resolution probably didn't see that one coming, but he is still very, very farmed. Already picked up a Shadow Blade before he ended up taking a spill. Phantom Laser, not sure what build he's going for. The Ags is decent, but I'm not exactly sure when the best time to get the Ags is. If you get it too early, you don't have the Fusil, so your Illusions don't do that much damage. But if you get it too late, your Phantom Lance damage just doesn't do that much. Like, you want your magic damage early on in the game when people don't have thousands of HP. So it's kind of a tough call as to when to get it.
And that's some great Observer Ward and Sentries down. With the Sentry down from DC, they understand just how safe Misery is. Until, Faces realize it themselves. Sentry for Sentry, Misery backs up, and the pressure goes into a very low tier 1 tower, and DC have a choice to make. They want to fight this. Weeha right now is getting a better trade-off in the mid, attacking into the tier 2 tower. I saw Shikuchi steal from the Rubick. Was he really going to reach? Rolling ball to forward with Stifling Dagger. They reach up to Sasa. Even Bowrider getting kicked by the stone of the Earth Spirit. Another Sentry Ward has to be planted. This time it's going to be the crit. Bringing down the VS, but the RP catches down Weeha. Lasso them back in. Keep the Firefly right on top of Faces. It's a good fight for TC if they can keep that damage going. A Resolution could do it from the back line. Misery is already dominating, getting a double kill out of this. And Jabs trapped up in the tree line. Weeha holding him in with the rest of the creeps. That is four heroes lost for Faceless and potentially more. They have no stun available to stop Black from TPing away to safety.
Wow, they went so deep, it's just the Ventral Spirit. It's not exactly the ideal hero to kill first. And on top of that, it was just a one-man RP coming out from Magnus. Downside of the Helm of Dominator build is that you don't really have that much mobility. Even with the Kobold Foreman, that's the only mobility that could possibly be provided by the Helm of Dominator creep. You just can't really get in there. He skewered in, but it was at their big teamfight ultimate. Magnetite, I suppose, wasn't used yet by Earth Spirit because he had already used the majority of his spells trying to catch out that Ventral Spirit at the start of the fight.
Yeah, he needs to have a little bit more mana up his sleeve for the next engagement as he's going to pick up his Arcane Boots now. And not the greatest fight for Faces, but perfect for Digital Chaos. Nicely kited. Misery actually did more damage than anybody else in that fight. Just Shikuching himself around, never really becoming a big priority target for Faceless.
Yeah, he hits for 150 right now. It's quite respectable as we ran. Still no deaths yet on Misery.
They found Rubick. Blink over, but with a solemn blink in the hands of Rubick, he's able to move away faster than the Batrider can catch up. Misery showing himself again. Rolling forward, almost actually connected. Misery was just a little bit late on the retreat. That's why the Earth Spirit missed his target.
Yep, Miss Silence. Nuts trying to perhaps get a better spell. Shikuchi, way better than Blink, I would say.
Well, he can just use both. Blink into Misery once he sees him. Get the quick grab on Telekinesis. You'd almost need to have like Magnus skewer into RP to hold him there to get the kill.
Nah, you need Earth Spear for that. Earth Spear has the instant cast. Oh. Skewer in is just way too slow.
Rubick, he just blinked in. And now Draw Ranger with the Gust, Nuts losing life very quickly, can blink again. He's got no real help and he's dying to the Scarab Beetle. And Misery knows that Nuts can't actually do anything to stop his own death.
That's a really smart play by Misery. If Misery had showed himself right there, he would have stolen Shikuchi and then he would have gotten away from the swarm.
Looks like DC is wondering about Roshan. Threw the sticky napalm in, now the dominated creep puts the tornado inside. Both teams thinking about the big man at the moment. But Faces need time. A Blink Dagger is still not up on Ice Ice Ice.
They have the Dezo and the Alpha Wolf on the PA, so she actually will crit for quite a lot of damage. And the Empower, mind you.
All they need is the control to go with it.
Yep, that is correct.
I'm wondering if Diffuser will do enough for that.
It's a healthy amount of damage. He also went for Treads too, so far more of a fighting build than the split push BOTs. That is the normal alternative.
Fusil is up. The only other critical item which you're looking for from Faceless is going to be a Blink Dagger on the Magnus before they'll be willing to fight, even if their supports don't have a lot to work with. They both had to build into Arcane Boots, or are both looking to build into Arcane Boots.
Oh,
one of them has it.
Rezzet just gets a free tower, free T2. Makes contesting that Roach just a little bit more difficult. Perhaps difficult enough to the point where DC might look into going in there themselves. They don't have a Helm of Dominator on their side, so no easy way for them to actually tank the Roach. I guess there is the Swarm available from Misery.
You still have the Shrines available. That's the advantage of the Radiant side.
Well, Blink Dagger is up. Quick TP to the Shrine. Will be a four-man smoke.
They look to Weeha. Black slows him down. A quick blink away, but Weeha up the river. Skewer forward. Weeha has his blink off cooldown in 1 second time. Another Stifling Dagger, another Silence. Now maybe you even commit it. No, you don't even need it. They keep the control up nicely, and with no Queen of Pain for 44 seconds, and an Alpha Wolf behind them, potentially, Faceless can now do Roshan.
Batrider is a menace around the pit, though.
Until he's got his 4-star, it's not going to be as effective. Has to blink out. Stifling Dagger to slow him down. Sticky Napalm is the steal from Nuts. Not exactly what he was searching for, but Faceless take the safer objective, and that's the tier 1 tower.
I still think Napalm's pretty good. It makes a turn rate, especially for heroes like a Weaver, who have no cast point on the Shikuchi, but need to turn around in order to run away. It's can be quite problematic. I would say Napalm is actually one of his better spells to steal.
Surprise Nuts didn't find harder to keep that Observer Ward up. I suppose Sykes could have just thrown down another Sentry Ward. Threw an Obs and a Sentry right on top of DC's Obs and Sentry. NFL's grouping up once again, and we have a smoke sitting on Nuts.
Wow, Phantom Lancer is eyeing for a BKB next, so very defensive build, I would say, with the strength from the treads and the BKB. Not something that you see quite often, but maybe his primary job is to stick on top of the Drow Ranger the entire fight, or deal with the Batrider the entire fight.
But you should be able to do that with also like things like Mana Style, right? Because that's also going to break you free, like both are going to break you free of the silence of the Drow Ranger.
Yeah, maybe he's worried about being bursted down by the Queen of Pain as well, or just not being able to doppelganger because he's silenced up.
I think it's true. Fine. BKB will keep that immunity going.
Oh, Centaur pops the smoke.
So they realize that at least one's there. Moon jumps in. Who's he go on? It's over on Ice. The support needs to arrive. Sonic Wave's going to connect over on three, but Ice is bailing out of here with a jump forward. Now you're up. He's going to connect, and Black will have time. A double kill actually in for Jabs and the Centaur. His stomps on the Vengeful Spirit. They roll forward, finding Moon and Digital Chaos. They're losing heroes left, right, and center down the hillside. A double kill for Black. And this time it is Faceless who will wipe 4-for-1.
Wow, that was a pretty decent initiation by Moon, but Magnus was just too tanky. They actually could not burst him down quickly enough, and now the damage is really starting to add up. Like, the Diffusal Blade on the Phantom Lancer is nice for the purge, but it's also nice because it gives him a ton of agility. And agility plus Empower, he is actually hitting for a lot right now, and I think he gets a bonus agility from the Phantom Rush as well. So, yeah, that to account for when you're getting right-click down. And agility also gives him a ton of armor, very easy to man up on the Weaver, the Ventral Spirit, and the Drow Ranger, who mostly rely on physical damage.
A little dusting around, though, waiting for some kind of infamous play, and yeah, Soxa came in a little bit closer, and that, with the swap up, he puts Misery in harm's way. He'll just time-lapse out to safety.
And the RP starting to be really fearsome in the team fights. How can DC actually deal with this? Normally, the Queen of Pain is kind of able to deal with the Magnus. The problem with Queen is she can't get in and out of fight. She can get in, but then she's just gonna die, and perhaps lends more credibility to Faceless Void or Faceless's ban of the puck over to Queen of Pain.
It seems like the range control too is great for Faceless, like their positioning. Like, you've got Earth Spirit on one side, Rubick on another, you're getting lanced up while being Mana Burn, Diffusal up, that's also a problem, but Black can just jump from one side to the other with that Phantom Strike. He's not really that restricted. And if you get the initiation through a Shadow Blade of Magnus, life is even harder. And I'm not even taking into account the sixth member of Faceless, which is that Centaur. He's always in the right position to get a Control Stomp off.
Yeah, that's actually a really nice use of that Helm of Dom from Magnus. I guess we see it more and more from offlanes, but it's just that extra bit of control so that Magnus can and Phantom Assassin can cleave them all down. Phantom Assassin's hitting really hard. With Empower, she's like 300. Combine that with a minus armor from Dezo, and then, God forbid, a crit from Phantom Assassin. That's just going to be devastating.
Faceless still have one very big problem. They're losing towers too quickly. So they only have that tier 2 tower remaining in the mid. At that point, DC can open up on the shrines. Faceless need to gain control of their side of the map.
DC have always been exceptionally good at putting pressure on the towers, even when they're slightly behind in terms of fighting ability. Net worth just barely in favor of DC right now. All that tower gold adding up, but now Faceless trying to take a fight down mid.
Yeah, they push it up. Again, these Empower buffed up cores. DC just don't want to go anywhere near, and you see just how hard they hit. Tier 2 tower looked more like paper than rock.
Power at work.
And they're going in. They're actually looking to go high ground. The Blink Skewer. They were only looking for the interruption on the Vengeful Spirit. Nothing more than that. But with the Alpha Wolf behind them, the damage output of all these heroes is huge. You get the Blink Lasso pulling back the Phantom Assassin. So Black's in trouble. Remember, he's the Aegis of the Immortal. Blinked a little bit further out. Bottom lane is being pushed in as well as top for Digital Chaos. They have momentum on those lanes, but Black, he's just going ham, commits the BKB. It's a three-man RP. Where's that cleave damage? It's not enough. Weeha will blink out. Moon's low. Black will get the crit, but he'll lose his life for it. The tier 3 tower is still very, very healthy, and Nuts has no easy way back out again. So he'll have to sacrifice his own life.
Wow, that was
Faceless are bailing. They got dragged in very deep.
There was no crit from PA. I think there was at least one crit. Two of the heroes would have just died instantly during the RP. So it was a bit of a gamble for Isis going in that deep. Of course, he knows it's right next to T4s, but three heroes in an RP with an empowered PA. Critting sounded pretty enticing.
Did he actually get the empower back up on the PA?
I saw him try and cast it again in the fight, because that's way more important than Magnus right clicking, unless you have like the Echo Saber build, but that is not the build that Magnus has turned towards this game.
Nice little status scout out, realizing DC's trying to steal their ancients. Maybe not as concerned about that while the PA is down, but giving the respect over Faceless. No reason to take a risk just for three ancients.
I do like the play for Moon to go on the PA. Like, PA, sure, she had Aegis and BKB, but because she has the Aegis, she doesn't feel like she really needs to use the BKB on her first life, and probably wasn't, like, you don't have your fingers on the BKB. You're like, Batrider's not going to go on me. But Batrider dragged her all the way to the T4 towers, and even despite her getting the Blink Strike out right before she perished with the Aegis, she's still just in a terrible position. Pretty much right on top of the shrines.
Makes life way too hard. This fool, wait till everything settles down, we'll get straight back into the game. But Misery, he's picked up the biggest item of all. So, you were talking about it, the real thing that makes it difficult for Faceless just to focus on one target, that Aghanim Scepter will arrive. But maybe it's also one of those other issues where, like, Faceless, like, they keep grouping them all up together, so you get the AoE damage anyway, so it's good. I hear we actually are going to have ourselves a little bit more of an extended break here, so make sure you grab yourself a beverage. We're going to come back after a very short break, as we'll change out a PC, and we'll come back to end game one of Faceless versus DC, well, the only game. We'll be back. And we are back live again after we've sorted out the issues nice and quick and into our best of one between Digital Chaos and Faceless. I'm Toby One again, joined by Molini. Hi. Welcome back.
Yeah. So, recapping what just happened, if you know, maybe
I've only just tuned in.
Yeah. Faceless had a slightly worse early game Drow Ranger and Queen of Pain kind of dominating their early games from CS. Battle Rider was a big nuisance, but Faceless Void struck back with a really big team fight, 4-for-1 in their own Radiant jungle. However, DC are keeping pace in terms of farm. Drow Ranger is highest CS in the game currently, and Roshan going to be eyed very quickly soon as Faceless just failed their high ground push with Phantom Assassin being pulled all the way back to the T4 towers.
Yeah, which is why we now see Faceless just trying to get control of their side lanes. That were the other things that were pushing in during that, and that's why that bottom tier 3 town down to 479. The top tier 3 tower was fine, but they took a lot more damage with the lane push more than anything else on the top lane.
And Drow Ranger's already preparing for late.
Moon is in a little bit of a world of hurt. He thinks he's actually away. Oh no, he blinks! Just in time, Magnus commit the RP, able to do so. So Moon caught out, only a sticky napalm steal, but it is still one very dead Moon Meander on the bot lane.
RP down, small silver lining for Faceless. Ags is going to be the next item for Drow Ranger. Very important. Ags Mjolnir is ridiculously good versus Phantom Lancer. I also think that's kind of a justified purchase for his BKB too, knowing that that's one of the ways for Drow Ranger to deal with him in the late game.
Mm-hmm.
Wow, DC scouting out Roshan 6 minutes after it last died. Somebody didn't take down the timer.
Well, you can't blame him. We did have the interruption, yep. So...
it's easy to forget.
Yeah. Had that stopwatch going on the side of your computer and then just forgot to stop the watch.
Usually they have it in chat. Most... I even know some pro players that have, like, three times down. One is when your age expires, one is when it first can spawn, and another one is when it last possible spawn. So, it's a very good habit.
Well, if you want to be a good support, do that for your team. Now, the other objective we were looking at was Faceless. How long they can keep this middle lane pushed out and pressure off their tier 2 tower. Because the second this goes down, they start losing shrines. And Digital Chaos are going to start having the same issue. With the dropping of that tier 1 tower on bot lane, Faceless are going to start adding pressure into the side lanes and then start taking out the shrines. And DC need that maneuverability. They need those shrines to fight near, not to mention having the regeneration on the front lines.
Well, they see the Phantom Lancer. Are they going to actually try and smoke up towards the Radiant Shrine?
They're coming to the Earth Spirit. So Earth Spirit, quick blink away. Moon won't hit his target. The Rolling Boulder will get XY out to safety. But bottom lane is where the attack was coming in from Faceless. Nuts is staying in the tree line. So the pick up, the throw down, the crits! Oh, well, Moon, welcome back to the world of the living. You can now return to the land of the dead. And Black wants to go for more, looking for more crits. Two hits, no crit just yet, but the Troll Trapper is moving forward. He can use that now over on Weehard. The blink out, Magnus can't get close enough. Would have had to skewer behind the tier 2 tower to make that work. So they have a catapult wave coming forward, and this means the tier 2 tower is 4 foot of DC on bot lane.
Hello, Empower.
It's a nice little buff. I say little. Does so much work for all of Faceless. We saw it when they ran the Magnus offlane earlier today, and we're seeing it again. And Digital Chaos are really on the ropes.
Well, one way to deal with the Empower physical damage is to pick up Ghost Scepter. That is Batrider's next item. However, not particularly useful versus the Phantom Lancers, though. They're kind of hard-pressed to find out how they can defend against this onslaught of physical damage that Faceless is bringing.
And that's such a quick Roshan.
Yep, Roshan is up immediately. No one even suspects it could be up this early.
Jazz would be like, just make an illusion and send one over. It should be able to... actually, it won't get there in time, not with the current PL illusions.
Nah. Phantom Assassin Helm Dominator Creep is going to be the easiest. So it looks like Phantom Assassin is actually going for the Lincoln Sphere. Very common pickup versus the Batrider, especially if you are a BKB carry.
Speaking of Batrider, Nuts. I thought for a moment Nuts is actually in a grab move before this would all happen. You can TP over the shrine if you want to. Nuts looking for some extra control. They get the silence on the Weaver. Magnus here for the RP! Three call, Black has to cleave on thanks to that being in power. Moon, Ghost Scepter's all buying him some time, but another Rolling Ball of with the Magnetize turn on, Black will find a triple kill on top of the shrine, and all three heroes of Digital Chaos do not have buyback. So this is an uncontested Roche or a push down mid.
Damn, what an RP from Ice right there. And I do like the failsafe in between the Weaver and the VS. If Weaver gets gone on, VS swaps him out. If VS gets gone on, I'm sure that he would probably get time-lapsed out. But that doesn't really work when you guys are still very clumped and Magnus is just preying on this positioning from Digital Chaos. And this T3 is under siege. It's at half HP.
Yep. Jabs is the only one really committing to it. Black actually bailed out to pick up the Lincoln Sphere. But the tier 3 tower is lost. They could do some damage into the range racks. But they're pinging out. They want to go for both. So the Dominator creep scouts out Roshan. They have an illusion rune to boot, so they can keep that up to scan out if DC want to TP into their own shrine to contest Roshan. And two wards, why not?
The Observer Ward doesn't actually give them that much vision, though. They don't have vision of the shrine itself. Those trees are obscuring that Observer Ward, so they might be in a little bit of trouble if DC can react fast enough, but it doesn't look like there will be.
Batrider's coming, but it's too late. The blink, the skewer, it gave him perfect vision of Moon's approach. With Vape Bolt down, the Firefly wears off, getting caught on the hillside. So Moon is down again, another 48 seconds, just as Faceless take Roshan and the Aegis with it.
Black is just doing ridiculous amounts of damage. They actually don't really have a good way to stop them. Like, they don't have very many stuns or ways to keep him in place. He hasn't even had to pop his BKB to get the damage off in most of these fights.
Yeah, that's an 8-second BKB still. But the Aghanim Scepter arrives for Weehaas. This makes the pushing high ground a little bit more difficult. Faceless. Just because of that really low cooldown on the level 3 Sonic Wave.
Mm-hmm.
Not to mention his talent tree, where he adds another cooldown reduction.
Yeah, they actually need to get level 25 on the Queen of Pain ASAP. That is one pretty good way to deal with the Phantom Assassin.
You're
if
looking for that life steal?
Yeah, the life steal and the blade mail. That's going to be a long ways away. I don't even know if they can start thinking ahead that far into the game. Last T2.
Yep. Spirit's the man who's been tasked with defending the bottom lane. He's hiding under the tower at the moment. Or hiding in the tree at the moment. And Misery feels very inclined to make a jump. There's a Blink Dagger on the Earth Spirit. So with an extra TP forward, he goes for the silence. This was all pretty much a trap with a follow-up stun. And Weaver, he fell for it. The swap out, the Sonic Wave will connect. But all of them come in the RP! Again, three heroes caught in an ice on the money. And they'll find Weehara Blink up to the high ground. He's really slowed up thanks to that Diffuser Blade and Jabs. Jumps up with him and again, another charge. Wee with the secondary Blink goes into the camp. Do they actually see him there? Well, they don't at the end. TP's all the way home, but that's a 3-for-1 trade-off, and your price was about 300, 400 damage to the tier 3 tower on bot.
They are very familiar with DC's ways of, okay, if we're behind, we're just gonna try and split push. Maybe not even with our carry, but with this time it was just the Weaver, but they were so prepared for that. And of course, I thought he's just nailing these RPs. He even has a Lincoln Sphere himself.
Moon is a non-factor. Like, how many times has he also died in just the last 10 minutes? It feels like way too many. He's 2-9-11 on the Batrider.
I feel like he's been getting crit a lot.
Yeah.
To be fair.
Yeah, I'm not saying it's Moon's fault at the moment. I'm just saying like Faces are just out positioning and catching him out a lot more than he's trying to actually catch them out.
They have damage issues. No one's really doing damage. Queen of Pain just kind of flops over if she tries to go in. She has no BKB. So if she gets silenced up by Earth Spirit, kind of dead to rights.
And her ult could almost does nothing too. Like the two big cores she wants to try and control who are doing the damage, the PL and the PA, both have BKBs. And one of them has a Lincoln Sphere, which he gave over to the PL.
Oh my
resolution. Okay, with the Aghanims plus the Maelstrom, those procs do some decent work against the PL, and now you see DC's high ground defense.
Yep, you gotta kill Rezo, or you have to have just way large of an item advantage to be able to push into that. And that's before he has his Mjolnir. Once he gets his Mjolnir, that's a crazy amount of damage. Goes from 4 bounces to 12 bounces.
But do you turn this now into a full split push? Like, do you avoid Digital Chaos because that? Or can you even do that? Like, when Draw Ranger can do the solo pushback on one lane?
I think you just need a gem on someone so that the Draw Ranger can't push out, nor can the Weaver. Once you get a gem up, you can kind of control their positioning.
It's already on XY.
Okay.
So the Earth Spirit got that vision. He was looking to buy it when that initiation started on bottom lane.
Yeah, get the gem, just kind of keep them controlled. keep them in. Drow Ranger, she's really hard pressed for item sides in the late game. You definitely want the Silver Edge because you want to be able to kill the PA. You want your Ags Mjolnir because that's all your damage. You want the Hurricane Pike too. It allows you to siege towers and it gives you some sort of survivability. And then what about your last slot? You want a lot of things. You want maybe an MKB to deal with the PA, to do even more Ags split damage to the illusions. You want a BKB perhaps so you just don't get run down. You might want armor so you don't get one shot by the PA. There's just so many different things for that last item. You might want a butterfly to help the precision aura damage. Like there's the possibilities are like, you know, 5 to 10 different items that she could get for that last slot.
I love the small little army. The two dominant creeps are slowly, very, very slowly taking out that shrine of digital chaos.
No risk.
It really is none. It's like, okay, they're gonna die. Great. I got more. Where that came from, Nuts running forward on Shikuchi, the quick blink away, Moon gets isolated, blink forward, actually gets dashed up, and the RP again! It's three in it! We have up with the high ground, but what's he gonna do apart from watch his teammates die? Three heroes again, only one of them has buyback, and it's the Batrider.
My god, ice with these RPs, they're just incredible.
It's kind of hilarious, because he ended the last best of three walking off, and he just said under his breath, like, I played like crap in the last game. In this game, he is so on point with every RP. He also got so much money early on, and what are you going to do to stop him? You can't even do it. Like, he sits invis, you know there's no detection. And he can even blink and skewer over on Weehar, and that's what he's probably considering at the moment, but hey, why not? Keep the attack going. You've already taken the mid-racks. Weehar's waiting for it. 8 seconds until Batrider is back up with the Weaver. They do a little bit of chip damage, and they're bailing.
I think this might just get worse and worse. Yeah, sure, Drow Ranger might pick up a Mjolnir, but then you're going to have to deal with the Refresher on the Magnus. Like, one RP is enough to slay three of your team members. Two RPs is just game over.
And digital chaos, could this be it? Could they actually be the second team out of Dota Pit? We eliminate one team per day on the first 2 days. Tomorrow, there's a lot more eliminations.
Dire, as you scan, they know that Faceless is poised near their shop. And there is a DV on the top lane. This could be a potential turnaround point for Resolution. Hitting for a whopping 500... Oh, wait, make that 660. That's with the Venjara, of course.
Yeah. The bad thing to have, problem is they're all out of position. PL is ready to force into the bottom lane. He needs a creep wave, however, but he'll start the attack, at least gets DC to look behind themselves and jabs. He's keeping up with the backdoor regeneration. And with the help of Black, actually, they wouldn't even care. The creep wave now arrives, and DC, they're going to take too long to TP in. Meanwhile, Jabs continues to replicate himself up. Misery's the neighborhood, and the RP again! Ice got him! He pulls him back with the skewer. Three gone. Sonic Wave, negligible damage, and this may just be it with a Solemn Gust. They're losing everything. The whole kit, Anchor Poodle, Weehaw will blink back into base. He'll be fine there, but with four heroes down, Batrider will buy back, making it three. You still don't have the big damage output. You never had it before, but now the draw and the VS are gone. You're losing all three lanes. Potentially the game.
No PKBs versus Ice's constant three-man RPs. They just they're just cut up into pieces.
Yep. No way to really survive, and they do it again. Nuts with a blink forward, still with that Stolen Gust. Weehaw, Ghost Scepters will save him, but he has to regenerate back up. Digital Chaos will have one last fight in them, and Faceless will be the ones to determine when this happens. The Megas are now up. Digital Chaos are locked inside their base. And Black, they turn around, they go back in again, they find Weehaw, the perfect gust, the perfect silence. He's down for 83 seconds, so again, Digital Chaos have to fight 4v5. Outnumbered and out-DPS'd.
So one of the big problems with Drow Ranger strats, you can take their T1s and their T2s, but after that, you're kind of lost as to what to do. You are very vulnerable in the team fights. You're not particularly good at pushing high ground. They couldn't really get an Aegis and let Resolution get really, really big this game. And at some point, they were going to have to win a team fight, but they just cannot control this Magnus anymore.
Well, they can't control anybody. You look at the control, if you just go through the Faceless lineup, it's second level Diffuser Blade now picked up by the PL. So you're not even going to be able to run away from the lineup. but you've got the quick jump in on the Magnus. You've got more control coming from the Earth Spirit with his Yule Scepter, but the Blink and the Rubik, he's done so much work with the Solar Drow Ranger Guts. I think he's actually done more silences than the Drows managed to achieve in this game. Well, and you've got a full Abyssal Blade on the Phantom Assassin. So whoever he finds is dead.
They had a small window, I think DC did, before the Magnus got his Blink Dagger, but it didn't seem like they were really able to capitalize on it. The thing about the having the Magnus on the lineup is that your melee cores just scale way faster. Normally, PA is not really a threat.
They see everything. It's the Observer Ward that's almost at the fountain. The RP will catch too, and this might be it. Let's... Drought Range can pump out the damage. He gets picked up, thrown back down again. Black is focusing him. Gavin get closer with the jump forward. Misery control. Timeless unavailable. Not. You should have seen the techies game with my 50,000 net worth. All right, so back into the game, and GG, it has been called with a skewer out. That is going to seal the end there for Digital Chaos. Faceless will take the best of one, and Digital Chaos will join Elements Pro Gaming on the sidelines of...